You're listening to Live from Lord North Street, the podcast of the Institute of Economic Affairs. I'm Christian Niemitz, Head of Political Economy here at the IEA. Capitalism is in retreat today. The Overton window, which is the range of socially acceptable opinions, has shifted massively towards the left in recent years. Defending free market nowadays often feels a bit like being a character in an Asterix comic. It's like living in the last Celtic village that still resists Roman occupation, and that is therefore constantly under siege from hostile forces. Joining me today is the author of a book with a very unzeitgeisty title, namely The Power of Capitalism, A Journey Through Recent History Across Five Continents, Dr. Rainer Zittelmann. Dr. Zittelmann is an entrepreneur and a writer, a management consultant, and a real estate expert. The book contains a number of case studies of countries that have liberalized their economies in one way or another at some point, and that have generally achieved very good outcomes as a result of that. China, unsurprisingly, is in there, and so is South Korea, so is Chile, and a number of places in Africa. But there are also a few cautionary tales of places that have traveled in the opposite direction and that have had terrible outcomes as a result. Venezuela is, of course, one of them. So, Dr. Zittelmann, you have been an entrepreneur for many years. The job of entrepreneurs is to work out what consumers demand and to deliver that. Now, if you go to any high street bookstore, it's pretty clear what sort of books sell well in this category here. It's Naomi Klein, it's Noam Chomsky, it's Rutger Bregman, Ha-Joon Chung. Clearly what the market demands is anti-capitalism. So you've done something very anti-entrepreneurial here. You've delivered the opposite of what the market wants. Why? What motivated you?
Yes, absolutely. So, and I'm in the good position that I don't have to earn money because I earned a lot of money as an entrepreneur, as an investor. But now I retired from entrepreneurship and I go back to where I come from. Originally, I'm a historian and I'm a sociologist as well. I wrote my second doctoral thesis some years ago in sociology. And now it's not about selling books. So I hopefully a lot of people will buy it. And this is one of the reasons I appreciate to having this interview here. But it's because of the message that is very important for me. When I start writing the book 2 years ago, I had a lot of discussion, and the main objection of everyone was, is it something new that capitalism is the better system than socialism? Everyone knows that. And what happened in the meantime? I came now yesterday from Berlin. And in the weekend, we had a demonstration with 40,000 people for expropriation of private property owners in Berlin. Some years ago, you couldn't imagine this. And even the head of the Green Party, that is, according to polls, now the second largest party in Germany, he agreed, yes, maybe we have to think about expropriation. And even the head of the CDU, that is a party of Angela Merkel in Berlin, he agreed, yes, if the referendum is for expropriation, then we have to do it, yes? And you couldn't imagine this a couple of years ago. And another thing that I read 2 weeks ago, the latest poll in the United States was about the attitude of young people toward socialism or capitalism. And 53% of young people under 30 embraced socialism, and only the minority embraced capitalism.
Yeah,
and
it's so about the same here.
I don't discuss about any theory, but I'm an historian from my profession, and I discuss about real life experience, and I don't compare real life experience with any theory.
But don't you know that that wasn't real socialism and that real socialism has just never been tried?
Yes, sure. I know this answer. And, I read your fascinating books about it. And so I know what to answer. After it failed, they tell you always it is not real socialism. But in the honeymoon period, I learned it from your book. They embrace it. No, but to be honest, You mentioned China is a little bit surprise why I start this book with China. But for me, China is the best example. we have this interpretation here in the Western countries what happened in China. A lot of people think this is a special third way between capitalism and communism. It's a kind of new idea with a big influence of the state, and this is a secret and so on. And this is all wrong. Sure, we have a lot of influence by the state in China today. But the reason is, when they started 30 years ago or 40 years ago, they started with 100% state. And then it was reduced. What did they do? They gave more power to the market, to private property. And this was a development through all these decades. And that it means nothing else than to have more capitalism, private property, market. And the result was that in 1981, we had 88% people living in extreme poverty in China, according to the official numbers of the World Bank. Today, according to the same statistic, it's only 1%. So this happened never in history before, that hundreds of millions Chinese people came out of poverty. And what happened at the same time, that some people became very, very rich. I think there's no other country in the world where we have so many new multimillionaires and billionaires. I think every week two new billionaires in China. And this is why it's so important. Because if people tell me about the gap between the poor and the rich and social inequality and all this stuff, you know, this discussion, they tell you always there's the gap between the rich and the poor. And I tell them something, the gap between the rich and the poor increased in China. We have less equality than we have 30 years ago. But I don't care about it. I care about the poor people. How is it for the poor people? And I've been in China and I discussed there with the people, and everyone is better than his parents were 30 years ago. But no one want to go back to China of the time of Mao Zedong, because everything was more equal there. And so you see, this proves that this so-called, what I called, zero-sum thinking is absolutely wrong, because these people, socialist people, they think always the rich became only rich because they took it away from the poor. And if this would be correct, the consequences, you have to take again now from the rich to give it to the poor, and then everything is okay.
Yeah, but which for China wouldn't have been a valid or a feasible approach, because there weren't any rich people apart from maybe a few party functionaries.
Yes, and Deng Xiaoping at this time after Mao began with these reforms, and his claim was that some people became very rich, and this worked. Some people became very rich, but in the same time, hundreds of millions Chinese people came out of extreme poverty only because of more private property and more market. I don't know whether they will go on this way. I discussed with one of the leading free market economists in China, and he was very skeptical about the development, what happens now in China. But to explain what happened in the last 30 years, this is one example why capitalism works better than socialism. And I have another example in my book about South and North Korea. And a lot of people don't know that in the 60s, everywhere in Korea, they were so very poor, like the poorest countries to do in Africa as well. It was in North Korea and it was in South Korea, the same. And then they took a different approach. In the North Korea, the planned economy, the socialism, and in South Korea, they took the capitalist approach. And now you see the result.
Okay, we can get to North and South Korea in a minute, but just to stick to the China example for a minute. How did this start initially? Because as you said, 40 years ago, it was pure socialism just after Mao's death. And there was no private sector to speak of. Did they want to move towards capitalism, or were they just trying to make variations within socialism? How did this happen?
Okay, First, they saw that it failed. It was a totally disaster what happened. My book starts with this. A lot of people don't know it, younger people. You should read it. That in the end of the 50s, 45 million people died as a result of the biggest socialist experiment in whole history. That was the so-called Great Leap Forward, what meant in reality a Great Leap Backward. And with 45 million people died. And after this died much more people in the Cultural Revolution. So, and the economic system was a total disaster. And then Deng Xiaoping understood he had to change something. But this is the difference now between socialism and capitalism. With socialism, you can implement it from the government. Now, from this day on, you have socialism. Capitalism, you can't implement from the government. He did some different things. In China, we had something like a grassroots movement everywhere in the country for more private property. And what the government did, they didn't stop it at this moment. This was very important. And this is a difference, for example, to former Soviet Union or Russian, where they try to implement something that they called capitalism, but as I see, it is not capitalism, because capitalism isn't something that you can implement only by the government. The government can give some opportunities, but it has to be a grassroots movement. This was the first thing. The other thing, they did a lot of experiments. They started with this special economic zones, like, for example, in Shenzhen, where I've been, now a city with, I think, more than 10 million people there, a lot of startups, entrepreneurship. But at this time, it was only with 50,000 people, very poor people, and a lot of people went there to go to Hong Kong. So they started to experiment all over China. They had the special economic zones. In the end, I think it were some thousand, and they were more capitalistic than we are here in the Western countries, or in the United States, or in Germany and in the UK. So it was not like a big plan. Now it's day zero, and we have a totally different system, but it was more like a trial and error and experiment and grassroots movements. Sure, there had to be someone in the party, in the government, who supported this movement. But this is one lesson you can learn from China. It's very important that you have not only the government, but you have a movement and a trial and error through the whole country.
Okay, I suppose the counterexample to that would be Chile under the Chicago Boys, or under the influence of the Chicago Boys. That's another chapter of your book. Yes. That was liberalization imposed in a top-down way. You had a military dictatorship. Yes. They had an economic crisis. They realized that they didn't know what to do about it. And they thought, there is this group of foreign-trained economists. They have a good reputation. Why don't we give them a shot?
This is absolutely correct, and I have a chapter in my book. But what you have to know, it's from the start, it didn't work from the start. On the contrary, they had a lot of problems in the start, and it was very important what they did. But the positive results came more and more after the end of the dictatorship of Pinochet. It's correct. It started this way, but first thing, in the start, it was not everything good. They had a lot of economic problems, and it needed a time as well, because this is the same lesson that you have in China. It's not only possible you have to have someone in the government who supports this and who has the initiative, but then you need time that it grows from like a grassroots movement. And I think so, it's not so different from this what happened in China. But I choose Chile and Venezuela for one reason. If you look at the index of economic freedom that you have every year by the Heritage Foundation. You see that Venezuela is together with North Korea and Cuba one of the worst, I think, place 130 or something like this, so with absolutely no economic freedom. And Chile is one of the countries with the most economic freedom in Latin America. And yeah. So you can compare it. And you can compare that in Chile they have growth and I think on average 5% through the last 20 years, what is an amazing example. And today, the refugees, they go their way from Venezuela to Chile and not the other way around. I think it never happened. I never heard that people, there are refugees from South Korea to North Korea or from West Germany to East Germany or from maybe from Miami to Cuba and so on. It's always the same way. Look where the refugees from where they come and where they go, and then you know what is a better system.
Yeah, that's stated preferences. Of course, people can say in a survey, oh yeah, I like the idea of socialism, but ultimately migration is the most honest feedback that you can give about the system. What you tell a pollster is one thing, but yeah, as you said, movements are almost always from economically less free to economically freer places.
Yes, absolutely. And you can see, maybe the one or the other will say, okay, the author selected his examples that they fit to his thesis. But this is not so. If you read chapter 8 about this index of economic freedom of Heritage Foundation that I mentioned, you see, if you look at the first, the 20 countries that are most free in the world. There are no refugees from only one of these countries. And if you look the last 21, a lot of people go, we have all these refugees coming from this, like, for example, African countries, where you have economic freedom. So this is important, because maybe someone can think, I selected only this example that fits to my thesis there.
Yeah, but those examples are also the closest things to natural experiments. Division of Korea, of course, is a perfect example, having pretty much exactly the same starting conditions. And then you can see the effect of these two different systems in practice. And another one of those natural experiments is, of course, the division of Germany, where in hindsight, it's pretty obvious that that East Germany would go socialist. It's not something that people saw coming at the time, but with the benefit of hindsight, we can say, yeah, this had to happen. You had a socialist party that had the backing of the Red Army and friends in high places in Moscow. Of course, they saw this as their once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and they took it. But what is actually more improbable, even in hindsight, is that West Germany would become a market economy, because the market economy wasn't popular at the time. The two main parties were opposed to it. And this may be a bit surprising to a British audience that actually German history isn't just Nazis and World War II. There's a lot more going on, especially in terms of economic history. And this is one of them, post-war history. How did that happen? How did West Germany become a market economy against the odds?
Yes, it's correct what you mentioned, that it was not self-evident. At this time, there were a lot of anti-capitalism in Germany also, and it was sometimes some people play an important role, and it was at this time Ludwig Erhard what was very important, and I think he had a good idea. He called it soziale Marktwirtschaft, it is in German, so like social market economy. But I think what he meant was market economy. But the word social meant for him only that the market economy is more social than any other economy. But the label was very important, because the people thought maybe it's a third way or something new. And I think it was, in a way, it was a good marketing idea to call it soziale Marktwirtschaft. And when you speak about the comparison between these countries, I think a lot of young people don't know and forgot what happened there. Today I spoke here with some journalists, economic journalists, well-educated people in UK, and I asked them, they should guess the percentage of people in East Germany, who had a telephone in 1989 when socialism came to an end. And no one guessed the right number. I can tell you it was only 16% of people in East Germany who had a telephone. In West Germany, it was 99% of the people who had a telephone. Or another number, I asked them, what do you think, how long you had to wait for a car? And he told me, oh, I think half year. Wrong! It was between 12 and a half and 16 years that you had to wait for a car. And then in the end, you could only choose between or select between a so-called Trabi and a Wartburg, two very, very bad cars. In West Germany, you could buy any car you want and you don't had to wait. You can you could go there and buy a car. And I think the problem today is that a lot of the young people, they don't know about this and they don't learn it at school. I found never someone who heard about the 45 million people who were killed in China with this great leap forward. They don't know about it. And they don't learn about such figures like East Germany with only 16%. And these were special people from the party, yes, yeah. who could get easier a telephone. And this is the reason why I wrote the book, because I think it's very important for young people to learn these things that they don't learn at school. They learn at school maybe how bad is capitalism and is responsible for hunger. And so what they don't learn, that in the last 30 years, more than 1 billion people worldwide came out of extreme poverty only through one reason, capitalist globalization. And so I think it's a great success story. It's the greatest success story. And especially it's important for poor people. A lot of people think capitalism is good for the rich and bad for the poor. I think the contrary is correct, because the strong people, they come along in every system, even in a dictatorship. They make their way everywhere. But the people who are not so strong, they need capitalism. You see it in Africa. Mm-hmm. Africa, one chapter about my book is in Africa. What they need is more capitalism, not development aid. If you compare the last 50 years, Africa got so much development aid, but still there today are so many people in hunger like in no other continent all over the world. And in Asia, they got not so much development aid, but they choose the other way, where we spoke about in China with more capitalism, in Taiwan with more capitalism, in South Korea or in Singapore and in Hong Kong. And so you see what helps, real world experiment. More capitalism helped in Asia, development aid in Africa didn't help them.
Okay, the counter example that people on the, well, maybe not so much the anti-capitalist, but at least market critics would bring up is Scandinavia. You have a chapter on that, yes, as well here. And this book was not originally written for an English-speaking audience. This is a translation. For most of those chapters, that doesn't really matter, doesn't really make a difference. This chapter on Scandinavia is the one which I think is actually more relevant to the English-speaking world than it would be to Germany, because it's more common here to have this misty-eyed impression of Scandinavia, and you hear the expression Scandinavian socialism quite often here. That's not something I've come across as long as I lived in Germany there. Scandinavia is usually seen as a proper social democracy, so the impression would be the Scandinavians are more or less like us, just better. They do it properly. Yes. They go further. Here you often get the impression that a lot of people think this is a completely different social model.
Yes, and this is wrong, and this is what my chapter is about. Sometimes countries, they keep their image much longer if the reality has changed. And Sweden is one example. It's correct. Sweden was an example for this, what they call democratic socialism. It was in the 60s and the 70s. But it was a total economic disaster at this time. And then they had reforms to reduce taxes. They still have high taxes and higher taxes than here. But in a lot of other aspects, Sweden is very capitalistic country. I come back again to this ranking of the Heritage Foundation, and I think today in 2019 it's number 20 out of 180 countries in the world, Sweden. That means one of the most capitalist countries in the whole world. Not an example. It's not in one row with Cuba or Venezuela, so not only more free. No, it's similar to United States, Germany, and other countries. And this is what people don't realize, that sure, they have higher taxes in something, but for example, they don't have inheritance tax, what we have here in Germany, and I think you have too. But with income taxes and so, it's correct, they have higher taxes and they have some aspects of welfare state. But in a lot of other things, they have this reforms. And so what these people dream of, this Scandinavian socialism, this didn't work in the 70s, and this was the reason why they had these reforms. And if they want the same system like it is now, okay, then I'm for this Nordic socialism as well, but it's a wrong name for it. It's a capitalist country like other capitalist countries are, with a mixture. Yes, to be honest, I start with a book with this. Nowhere in the world we have pure capitalist system, and we have nowhere pure only where the state has everything. Even North Korea, you have some elements of market and private property, and yet in Sham Democratic Republic, it's always the question of the how much it is from the state and market economy. And for me, this history is like a test tube. If you give, it's a mixture between state and market, and then you see what happens if you give more state or more market. And this is what I'm doing in this book. And you saw, if you gave too much state in the test tube, like they did in the 70s in Sweden, it didn't work. It was economic disaster. And then they learned from this and they gave more market, and then it worked better again.
Yeah, what Scandinavia shows, I guess, is that if you get absolutely everything else right, then you can get away with high taxes. But if you did the same in a less functional economy, they could never afford a Swedish-style or a Danish-style tax burden.
Absolutely.
It's more they can compensate for their high taxes by getting a lot of other things absolutely right. So on the apart from the economic freedom index, there's the ease of doing business index, which is a bit different. It's not about economic freedom per se, but it is about how business-friendly an environment is. How long does it take to get a license to do this or that? And they always have Denmark on top, and Sweden also doing been pretty good. And it just shows those economies that get the business environment, the legal system, all the legal surroundings right, they can
no corruption
afford higher taxes.
If you look at this Transparency International Index, yes, there are this Nordic states are always at the top with having no corruption. So this is a misunderstanding of some people that capitalism means only free market. There are a lot of other things. If you look at this Heritage Foundation, there's 12 different aspects, and taxes is one of these 12 aspects. And we have a lot of other aspects like labor market regulation and the legal system and a lot of other things.
I read something about the privatization period in Sweden, which I think was in the 90s when Göran Persson was prime minister, and it reads a lot like what happened here in the Thatcher period. It's just that Sweden never acquired that reputation of being a place. It's never associated with privatization.
It was a similar development. And if you come back to the socialist time for a moment, because I think it's interesting here for people here, if you speak what it meant, socialism, for example, maybe you know the founder of IKEA with the furniture, yes?
And he Ingvar Kamprad.
Ingvar Kamprad, yes? And he had to pay such high taxes that he moved away from Sweden, first to Denmark, but that was not better. And then the next decades of his life, he lived in Switzerland. So, or another example was this author of books for children, Astrid Lindgren. Yes, and she wrote an article in one of the leading Swedish newspapers, a fairy tale about taxes, and she made a calculation that she had to pay 102% taxes. And the then finance minister of Sweden told her she couldn't calculate, she should go on writing her fairy tale, she understands nothing about taxes. But in the end, they checked it, and the prime minister of Sweden at this time, Olaf Palme, he had to agree, yes, she was right, it was 102% taxes that she had to pay. And this was one thing that when the way started back in the other direction. So this was there are a lot of examples in my book what happened there in this bad time. So maybe take it with you if you hear it. Sweden was socialist, correct, in the 70s, but it's not more, and they changed it because it was a disaster in every, yes.
Yeah, so it's fair to say Sweden can get away with higher taxes than most places in the world because of an efficiently run public service, and also a higher willingness, high levels of trust in government institutions and general social trust. They can get away with higher taxes, but once they move towards proper socialism, nationalizations, interfering with market prices, that's something that doesn't work even there. In those terms, Sweden is just like any other country.
Yes.
They can't make the laws of Econ 101 go away.
Yes, you can. I think it's interesting. You can. I mentioned several times this index of economic freedom of the Heritage Foundation. You can find it in the internet, and it's free. It's 400 pages, I think 450 pages or something like this. And you find about every country the rating. And it's I think it's two or three pages about every country. And if you look to Sweden, you can find in this aspect, yes, they are capitalistic and this not. And then in the end, they get that rating. So maybe it's a recommendation. Look in the internet for this Heritage Foundation Index of Economic Freedom, and then you can check it for every country and compare it.
Yeah, I've done that calculation once, where for the Scandinavian economies, I took out the subcomponent in the index, which is about the tax burden, the size of government. And once you take that out and look at what remains, on that rest index, they are higher than the UK and the US.
Yes.
It really is only that category that pulls them down.
Exactly.
But if you can find the book on Amazon, it's again The Power of Capitalism, A Journey Through Recent History Across 5 Continents by Rainer Zittelmann. And for more podcasts, films and reports, visit our website at iea.org.uk.